Hello and welcome to News Flash, a show where we track the developing stories of the day. An app has become a talk of the town in this country. This is an app that uses augmented reality and can either make you look 20 years younger or even 50 years older. People, celebrities, all of them are having fun, great fun using this app. The aging app is also in the middle of an age-old controversy, that of data misuse as well as leak. The app has been criticized for being of Russian origin, for imposing strict terms and conditions whereby they can permanently keep and use all your photographs. All of this reignites the classic debate of data protection and prevention of possible misuse. So on the face of it, if you use this app, boy, many will say that this is pretty close to reality. People are enjoying this very harmless exercise of seeing how they will look 50 years from now or 30, 40 years from now. But is it harmful? The same classic debate of them using their data. We're going to discuss this. I have Jitin Jain, he's an ethical hacker as well as a cyber expert with me in the studio. Nikhil Pawa, the editor of medianama.com, is also with us. Joining us from Pune is Samir Anja, co-founder and COO of Arca, as well as Ritesh Bhatia. He's also a cybersecurity expert. Thank you very much, because I feel that this is a very significant issue, especially when the whole world and Indians as well are tripping over this amazing app called FaceApp. It was down for a couple of hours yesterday, but it's back online, I'm being told. So we'll begin with you, Jitin. First of all, let's talk about the app itself. Do you think it's cool?
No, I used it myself. The app is really cool, amazing. And you see, we have seen a lot of Facebook applications in the past, which actually predicts how will you look 20 years from now, 25 years from now. But, you know, they were not up to the mark in terms of quality. But if you actually use this app, the photos are so realistic, as if, you know, you can feel that this is how I'm going to look 20 years from now. And the pictures are amazing.
And then you have all stars who have also taken a liking for this app. I mean, the who's who.
And this is one such app where you can actually use it without posting stuff on Facebook. I mean, others are actually forcing you, asking a lot of permissions or, you know, access to your Facebook profile and stuff. Here you could just, you know, install in mobile apps. And that's where the entire controversy is all about. This is not a Facebook app. This is a real mobile app and kind of permissions they are taking, kind of privacy policy they have and the terms and contract conditions they have.
So let's talk about those terms and conditions. Like, I have to name a few. Let's quickly put up that graphic also on the screen right now. What is this app actually trying to do? The app converts users' current image to an old age photo, which we have established and people know. The app's policies could allow collection of images uploaded on the app, which means even if you do not augment yourself as 50 years from now, just sync your photo album, it could have access to those pictures as well.
You see, there are three things which happens in an app, you know, when you install it. One is the terms and condition and the contract which you know sort of digitally sign. Another is a set of permissions which the app asks you and which you actually have to give when you want to install the app. Third is the actual data which is flowing. I've tested the app, I've intercepted the traffic also. So what we have figured out, that no doubt it takes all the permission to access your photo gallery, Wi-Fi location, data, SMS, call records and whatnot. But that, you know, I mean, it is, these are all classic signs of a malware. But the problem is, you name any app, you know, across the world, be it WhatsApp, Facebook or Google Hangout, they take out exactly the same set of permission. There is no difference. So it is left to the intent of the developer now. So that is where the Russian origin is being questioned. Now I'll come to another thing, the contract. They say whatever photo you upload or, you know, try to make how old you will look, we will have the right to reuse, manipulate and, you know, reproduce those photos without your consent.
Correct.
Now, but everyone else is also doing it. So today we have a story where Google has been listening to your, you know, conversations and sending it to third parties. Alexa has been listening. Siri collects your conversation. So everybody has been doing it. Everybody has been giving it to the
so
third
this
party.
App is
these people have written about it.
Yeah.
And even if you or me were a company, we will also do the same. Third is about the interception of data, what actually data is being transferred. So when we check, there are three things which are definitely going. One is your IMEI number, your device and, you know, model and other details of the device. Third thing what is going, which is like, which was really surprising, which is without the consent of user. I mean, I will not say consent, it is going with a tricked consent. The user is not informed every time. Every photo which you're trying to, you know, put onto the app to, you know, manipulate it or put it on an AI engine to predict how will you look 20 years from now, that photo and the AI version of it, which makes you look 20 years later, is going to the server. Now, this is technically without consent, users are not very clear about it because, I mean, there is a lack of data privacy in India.
No, but that's
so once
that's
you sign the contract, they'll go.
The rules and norms say, let me go across to Mr. Power. Nikhil Power, the rules, the FaceApp rules and norms say that you grant them permission to use photos and user information. The company can use images for commercial use. It is part of the contract. And this is royalty-free license to the app to use your images. Royalty-free. Right? Do you think that this is harmless and we should not raise a stink because everybody does it?
Well, I think what this indicates to us is the failure of the consent mechanism. Most people want download this app because it looks cool. No one bothers to read privacy policies because they're written by lawyers and they're extremely long, verbose. And these little bits are hidden in that policy with the verbiage that it has. So therefore, you know, for most people, they just click OK and they go on with it and they give access to everything. Mm. I think a part of the problem lies with the Android operating system by itself, which gives substantially large permissions to apps. And many app developers actually struggle with iOS because Apple gives them fewer permissions to do things, cool things like these. There is a negative side to these permissions that are taken, but this is true of many apps. Facebook's terms and conditions also have this. I'm sure Google's terms and conditions also have it. Instagram's terms and conditions will also have it. Many of these apps use this photo shift to promote themselves, but users aren't aware that this is possible. And I think what's happened with this controversy is that it's a good thing that this controversy has erupted because more and more people will be aware of these problems. But tomorrow a new app will come. The question is, will they then read the terms and conditions or not? So there is a case to be made for simplified, easier to use, more precise consent mechanism so users know what they are signing up for. You know, most people don't read these things.
Okay. Okay, Sameer Anja, let me come to you. Do you think that this is another case of things being left to the wisdom of the people who are using it? That because of this controversy, people will be a bit more aware. They will read those terms and conditions. Because I don't think apps work like this. No. Most of the people who downloaded this app, I don't think they took out time to read the terms and conditions.
Yes, I believe that most people will not read. And going forward as well, people are not going to read. So I agree with Nikhil that A, it needs to be simpler. One good thing that I can see that has come out of the whole thing as a controversy or as a known thing is at least that people will now be more aware of what is happening around them and they may choose to do or not to use the particular app. Because as of now, we were just going by popular choices and just accepting whatever was coming in. The fact that the controversy has come means there is a question mark that is coming up everywhere saying why should we use it? And which is actually a good thing to happen for us.
Okay. I'll come to you. Let me quickly take in a view of Mr. Ritesh Bhatia also. I'll come back to you. Mr. Bhatia, now I want to talk about the role that the government has to play. See, the government has been talking about TikTok. It has been talking about Facebook, WhatsApp. It had tried to summon the CEOs of these big giants. And frankly, it has failed at every step of the way. So what choice or what chance do we have of the government intervening?
See, Sanket, over here, when we talk about the government intervening, right now we don't have any laws. And that's the reason since long everybody in the community is pushing for the PDPA, that is our Personal Data Protection Act, to come in at the earliest. Now, when we are talking about the FaceApp, now FaceApp is the registered address is showing as, although these people are Russians and that is the reason all this furor is there, but if you see, they have put their offices in America, they have registered it over there. So right now, we have nothing as such, even, they don't even come under GDPR, unfortunately, you know, because they've shown, I think they deliberately made their offices and they are hosting all this particular data in US. And why just FaceApp? What happens about all those other things like TikTok and, you know, things like Instagrams and Snapchats? We also need to understand that over there also, we are giving our well-lit photographs. And this has become nothing but a fodder for artificial intelligence algorithms, Sanket.
Okay. Yes, you wanted to come.
Sanket, you know, we must understand that, you know, instead of being reactive.
Yeah, Nikhil, I'm going to come to you.
Reacting and, you know, creating this ruckus every time. We do not have a data privacy law in India. And there was a caveat in the law, in the draft law, that any company which collects data will only use it for that purpose. So if this app, if the data, the protection law was in place, if this app has collected data for just predicting how you would you look 20 years from now, they could not have used this, your personal information, for any other purpose or given it to any other
third
party.
But then,
because we do not have that law, the only game behind this entire business is that it's a free app. There is no free lunch in life. It's a data harvesting scheme. It is a scheme to train your AI engine to be more accurate, more precise, which can be used tomorrow for all sort of image recognition.
Okay, mechanism. Does that happen?
It happens. I mean, you look at the Facebook's 10-year challenge. Do you think that's stupid to, you know, put a hashtag and let it go viral? It is because, you know, you collect people's photo, how they look 10 years back and how they look now, so that your AI can predict how they will look 10 years from, you know, later. And so a lot of image recognition technologies which are being used by intelligence agencies and police now, they are almost 90% accurate today. I mean, 10 years from now, with the use of AI and NL, they will be 99.9% accurate. And these sort of mechanisms which look into the future, which can predict how will a face look. So if I have your photo today, and if I had to look that how Sanket would have looked 10 years ago, how do I do it without AI?
Okay,
and to use that AI, I need to train that AI, and for that I need realistic data. So these things where people crowd up and queue up and give you millions of pictures
voluntarily,
what best scheme could have been there free of cost to, you
Jitin,
know, train
Jitin
your
Jain,
AI.
You're scaring the daylights of people.
I mean, this is what is happening. Yeah. I mean, believe it or not.
Okay.
This is the whole game.
Nikhil, you wanted to come in.
Yeah, so, you know, I would disagree with the point made that the GDPR is not applicable. If users in the EU are using this app, then the GDPR is applicable.
The common viewer
and
can
in that sense, if we had...
Nikhil, if you could explain what is the full form of these abbreviations that you used.
Right. So the GDPR is the General Data Protection Regulation, which is applicable in the European Union. And that is the strongest privacy law in the world right now. And that requires consent to be simplified and not taken without the user actually understanding what they're getting into. At the same time, there is a strong regulation in terms of harms. See, even today, we cannot trust companies with how they use data. Facebook has a long history, not just forget FaceApp. Facebook itself has a long history of violating users' privacy, apologizing, paying a fine in some instances, and then going back and doing different things. So we need a strong data protection law. That data protection law needs to come. We need one in India as well. And I have no idea why Ravi Shankar Prasad is delaying the tabling of this bill. If you look at the economic survey that came out, even that mentioned that the economic survey expected the data protection law to have been tabled by then. So this delay is not working for Indian users. It is allowing companies to harvest data. And we really can't trust companies, just like we can't even trust government. Who has the largest facial recognition data in the world today? It is probably the Indian government that has it for Aadhaar users, right? There is a Digi Yatra system that is being set up at airports that is going to be looking, that's going to be using facial recognition. So, unfortunately, instead of data minimization, and especially of facial recognition data, we are leaking our facial data every time in every photo. Actually, facial recognition, it's been actually cloned, and facial recognition systems has been they've been fooled even through high resolution photographs. So it's a privacy
it's a
security nightmare in
so
some
countries. I think almost would, on I the would, lines
no,
of yeah.
also there are CCTV
one moment Ritesh
so, you know,
Bhatia as well as
CCTV cameras
Sameer.
That are being put up even the Delhi government is looking at that.
Nikhil, I'll come back to you. Ritesh Bhatia as well as Sameer Anja, do you think that the answer over here is for the government to move fast and get a data protection law in place quickly?
Absolutely, and it is very fast. They should have done it like yesterday kind of thing. And it is just not for because this face app is, you know, as Nikhil rightly pointed it out, and Jitin also said the same thing, that anything that happens, and you know, like we always talk about the privacy, but where is the Privacy Act? Now also they, you know, want to come up with the health record system, they want to come up with many more, you know, and especially with so much of digitalization, and you know, we have become globally, there are no borders now left. So it's very, very important that the act comes up soon, and especially when you're talking about data localization too.
Okay. Mr. Anja.
So just 2 points here. One, yes, absolutely, the India Privacy Act is definitely required. But more important than that, it is also about not just privacy, but protection of the data.
Hmm.
And since we are looking at data that is going to be stored, residing somewhere, those portions of our act is going to be equally crucial in terms of the security, as well as how the data can be misused. Like if you look at the FaceApp thing, they're at least saying we are going to use your photos everywhere else. But there could be a large part of misuse that will come in, as well as the data itself can be stolen and leaked. And that is something that is more worrying. Because not just them, somebody who hacks into them could also be using it. And
those portions
is where we need to worry about even more than just the regular threats.
Okay, Jitin, let me come back to you. You know, the point is that on their part, should they be excused simply because they have been honest enough to admit that, see, we will use it royalty-free for commercial use? I don't think that can be justified.
I don't think it's wrong. I mean, as long as they pick only that photo which they have, you know, used to create an AI-based.
But we don't know.
But with the kind of permissions these applications have, tomorrow if they were to pick each and every photo of you without your consent, nothing could stop them because they've already given them the permission. So problem is not today, problem may happen tomorrow. In the absence of data privacy law, you'll not be able to able to prosecute them. So my submission is that, you see, government is in a catch-22 situation. They've been like, you know, there is always a school of thought which says that government should not collect excessive data, like biometrics and stuff. But we all,
the whole Aadhaar technique, controversy.
I mean, there are many other things. But we have to understand that governments across the world will have access to such data, believe it or not, maybe today or 5 years later. And it is necessary, because if you don't give it to Indian government, you are anyways giving it to the US government when you apply for visas.
Yeah.
I mean, every airport you land in the foreign, you know, country, you have to give your biometrics. So you will have to share your biometric details, whichever jurisdictions you go into it. So governments will always be the custodian of such data. The problem is with the private companies, that too, which are outside India. Now for that, you see, the problem is, even if you had have GDPR, even if you had a data privacy law in India, if government was to ban TikTok today, or government was to take coercive action against Instagram or Facebook today for violating data pipelines, or even they were to ban them, you know, put a penalized ban, even say for 5 days, the entire country will erupt that you're twisting arms. You are, you know, I mean, the moment these companies were summoned in the parliament, they refused to come. And when governments, you know, gave coercive words and coercive, you know, statements, they were like, oh, you are, you know, twisting the muscles because of elections and all.
But
so as a society, we have to somewhere, you know, believe in our government and give them that room to exercise.
That's a very significant
point. If you allow a scot-free run for TikTok, Instagram and Facebook,
then they will have a feeling.
We are going towards disaster.
Okay. Nikhil Pawa, you wanted to, would you like to comment on this? Do you think that this resistance
so we have to delink Aadhaar with these social media companies. I mean, these are two different things. That's my own judgment. And give government trust and room to act against those companies which are actually stealing data of Indian users.
Okay. Nikhil Pawa.
Yes. I am disinclined to trust a government that went to the Supreme Court and said that I have no fundamental right to privacy, that said that all of us citizens have no right over our own bodies. And these were actual words that were used by the lawyers representing the Union of India and the Supreme Court. And therefore, I think it's a responsibility of every citizen to question the government, to not trust the government and keep questioning them, because it is individual privacy that matters over here.
But
even
Nikhil,
in the economic
trust?
Survey and recent statements like the e-commerce policy, please let me finish. Even in those policies, they're saying that citizens' data is the government's asset and they will monetize it. There is talk, even in the economic survey, of selling data to private companies. You know, so I would disagree with Jitin on this point of trusting the government. I don't think we should trust anyone. We should question everything. We should question every app. We should question every platform. We should question every government. And in each country, I know that many people are forced to give their data to countries that they need to travel to. But they have many of these countries have privacy laws. We don't. Our government is delaying putting out a privacy law.
No, that's exactly the point that we are discussing.
Just one line, Saket. You know, Nikhil is a dear friend. Just one line of disagreement. I think as citizens, we must question wherever it is necessary and we should trust wherever they deserve. So we just should not trust blindly and we should not question every time. We have to be, you know, selective. We have to see if it is worth questioning, we should. If it is worth fighting, we should. If it is worth trusting, if they deserve, we should.
Okay. Ritesh, very quickly.
But we also, Jitin, sorry, can I make one small point?
Please go ahead.
There are CCTV cameras that are being set up in Delhi. right? We should also question the Delhi government. We should not trust the Delhi government, because even today the policy for CCTV cameras is not available in the public domain.
Yes.
There were consultations, but the outcome of that consultation is not available. Yeah. We should not trust, my thing is, we should question every government act of collecting data, and we should continue questioning it.
Okay.
Whether it is, and especially CCTV data is going to be used for facial recognition in the future.
Yes.
All of our movements across cities are potentially going to be tracked. Using facial recognition, they're going to be identified on cameras everywhere.
So while these we must question,
towards a panopticon and a surveillance state.
There is a plus as well as a minus for every use of technology. CCTVs have also helped crack many, many criminal cases in this country.
The fascist countries or dictatorial regimes like China or Iran, or you take greatest democracies like United Kingdom of America.
Yeah.
Every public area is now covered by CCTV. We are just a developing economy.
But I think Nikhil's point is that there should be a policy.
But yes, we must have an oversight regime. We must have a constitutional mechanism to, you know, oversee and protect the citizens.
My last question of the day, Ritesh Bhatia. There's this write-up, an article in Wired.com, which says that you're worried about your permissions of FaceApp. Wait till you find out the sort of permissions you give to Facebook. This is not even the tip of the iceberg.
Absolutely. Yeah. You know, and that's the reason, see, right now for the viewers, it's very important to understand that what all can happen when you are like giving away permissions blindly.
Yeah.
So it's very important. Go back to your phone, go to the settings. There are apps and permissions, and revoke certain things.
Yeah.
Like when the users are giving permissions to read the SMS. No, it will function. No, Sanket. It will function. You just got to like when you're giving permission to read the SMS, they are also able to read your OTPs.
Okay.
So please, we need to understand that revoke we just have this particular belief. Yeah.
Okay, fine. Ritesh Bhatia, Samir Anjar, Nikhil Pawa, as well as Jitin Jain, thank you very much. Let's hope that this discussion will carry a little bit of weight the next time people download this app.